The Wife by Anton Chekhov. Chapter 1. I received the following letter. Dear Sir, Pavel Andreich, not far from you, that is to say, in the village of Pestrovo, very distressing incidents are taking place, concerning which I feel it is my duty to write to you. All the peasants of that village sold their cottages and all their belongings and set off for the province of Tomsk, but did not succeed in getting there and have come back. Here, of course, they have nothing now. Everything belongs to other people. They have settled 3 or 4 families in a hut, so that there are no less than 15 persons of both sexes in each hut, not counting the young children. And the long and the short of it is, there is nothing to eat. There is famine, and there is a terrible pestilence of hunger, or spotted typhus. Literally, everyone is stricken. The doctor's assistant says one goes into a cottage, and what does one see? Everyone is sick, everyone delirious, some laughing, others frantic. The huts are filthy. There is no one to fetch them water, no one to give them a drink, and nothing to eat but frozen potatoes. What can Sobol, our Zemstvo doctor, and his lady assistant do, when more than medicine the peasants need bread, which they have not? The district Zemstvo refuses to assist them on the grounds that their names have been taken off the register of this district, and that they are now reckoned as inhabitants of Tomsk, and besides, the Zemstvo has no money. Laying these facts before you, and knowing your humanity, I beg you not to refuse immediate help. Your well-wisher. Obviously, the letter was written by the doctor with the animal name or his lady assistant. Zemstvo doctors and their assistants go on for years, growing more and more convinced every day that they can do nothing, and yet continue to receive their salaries from people who are living upon frozen potatoes and consider they have a right to judge whether I am humane or not. Worried by the anonymous letter and by the fact that peasants came every morning to the servants' kitchen and went down on their knees there, and that 20 sacks of rye had been stolen at night out of the barn, the wall having first been broken in, and by the general depression which was fostered by conversations, newspapers, and horrible weather, worried by all this, I worked listlessly and ineffectively. I was writing a history of railways. I had to read a great number of Russian and foreign books, pamphlets, and articles in the magazines, to make calculations, to refer to logarithms, to think and to write, then again to read, calculate, and think. But as soon as I took up a book or began to think, my thoughts were in a muddle. My eyes began blinking. I would get up from the table with a sigh and begin walking about the big rooms of my deserted country house. When I was tired of walking about, I would stand still at my study window, and looking across the wide courtyard, over the pond and the bare young birch trees and the great fields covered with recently fallen, thawing snow, I saw on a low hill on the horizon a group of mud-coloured huts, from which a black muddy road ran down in an irregular streak through the white field. That was Pestrovo, concerning which my anonymous correspondent had written to me. If it had not been for the crows who, foreseeing rain or snowy weather, floated cawing over the pond and the fields, and the tapping in the carpenter's shed, this bit of the world about which such a fuss was being made would have seemed like the Dead Sea. It was all so still, motionless, lifeless, and dreary. My uneasiness hindered me from working and concentrating myself. I did not know what it was, and chose to believe it was disappointment. I had actually given up my post in the Department of Ways and Communications, and had come here into the country expressly to live in peace, and to devote myself to writing on social questions. It had long been my cherished dream. And now I had to say goodbye both to peace and to literature, to give up everything and think only of the peasants, and that was inevitable, because I was convinced that there was absolutely nobody in the district except me to help the starving. The people surrounding me were uneducated, unintellectual, callous, for the most part dishonest, or, if they were honest, they were unreasonable and unpractical, like my wife, for instance. It was impossible to rely on such people. It was impossible to leave the peasants to their fate, so that the only thing left to do was to submit to necessity and see to setting the peasants to rights myself. I began by making up my mind to give 5,000 gold rubles to the assistance of the starving peasants, and that did not decrease but only aggravated my uneasiness. As I stood by the window or walked about the rooms, I was tormented by the question which had not occurred to me before, how this money was to be spent. To have bread bought and to go from hut to hut distributing it was more than one man could do, to say nothing of the risk that in your haste you might give twice as much to one who was well fed or to one who was making money out of his fellows as to the hungry. I had no faith in the local officials. All these district captains and tax inspectors were young men, and I distrusted them all as I do all young people of today, who are materialistic and without ideals. The district zemstvo, the peasants' courts, and all the local institutions inspired in me not the slightest desire to appeal to them for assistance. I knew that all these institutions who were busily engaged in picking out plums from the zemstvo and the government pie had their mouths always wide open for a bite at any other pie that might turn up. The idea occurred to me to invite the neighbouring landowners and suggest to them to organise in my house something like a committee or a centre to which all subscriptions could be forwarded, and from which assistance and instructions could be distributed throughout the district, such an organisation which would render possible frequent consultations and free control on a big scale would completely meet my views. But I imagined the lunches, the dinners, the suppers, and the noise, the waste of time, the verbosity and the bad taste which that mixed provincial company would inevitably bring into my house, and I made haste to reject my idea. As for the members of my own household, the last thing I could look for was help or support from them. Of my father's household, of the household of my childhood, once a big and noisy family, no one remained but the governess Mademoiselle Marie, or as she was now called, Maria Gerasimovna, an absolutely insignificant person. She was a precise little old lady of 70, who wore a light grey dress and a cap with white ribbons and looked like a china doll. She always sat in the drawing room reading. Whenever I passed by her, she would say, knowing the reason for my brooding, "What can you expect, Pasha? I told you how it would be before. You can judge from our servants." My wife, Natalia Gavrilovna, lived on the lower story, all of the rooms of which she occupied. She slept, had her meals, and received her visitors downstairs in her own rooms, and took not the slightest interest in how I dined, or slept, or whom I saw. Our relations with one another were simple and not strained, but cold, empty and dreary as relations are between people who have been so long estranged, that even living under the same roof gives no semblance of nearness. There was no trace now of the passionate and tormenting love, at one time sweet, at another bitter as wormwood, which I had once felt for Natalia Gavrilovna. There was nothing left either of the outbursts of the past. The loud altercations, upbraidings, complaints, and gusts of hatred which had usually ended up in my wife's going abroad or to her own people, and in my sending money in small but frequent instalments that I might sting her pride oftener. My proud and sensitive wife and her family live at my expense, and much as she would have liked to do so, my wife could not refuse my money. That afforded me satisfaction and was one comfort in my sorrow. Now, when we chanced to meet in the corridor downstairs or in the yard, I bowed. She smiled graciously. We spoke of the weather, said that it seemed time to put in the double windows, and that someone with bells on their harness had driven over the dam. And at such times I read in her face, "I am faithful to you and am not disgracing your good name, which you think so much about. You are sensible and do not worry me. We are quits." I assured myself that my love had died long ago, that I was too much absorbed in my work to think seriously of my relations with my wife. But alas, That was only what I imagined. When my wife talked aloud downstairs, I listened intently to her voice, though I could not distinguish one word. When she played the piano downstairs, I stood up and listened. When her carriage or her saddle horse was brought to the door, I went to the window and waited to see her out of the house. Then I watched her get into her carriage or mount her horse and ride out of the yard. I felt that there was something wrong with me, and was afraid the expression of my eyes or my face might betray me. I looked after my wife and then watched for her to come back, that I might see again from the window her face, her shoulders, her fur coat, her hat. I felt dreary, sad, infinitely regretful, and felt inclined in her absence to walk through her rooms, and longed that the problem that my wife and I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.